Talking about the Delhi Sultans. So what we have seen in the previous discussion is the regions like the Kaveri Delta, they became the center of large kingdoms. But Delhi, because we are talking about the Delhi Sultans, Delhi was not a very important city at this point of time. Delhi became an important city only in the 12th century. So let me take you to a table first. This is the table for rulers of Delhi. Who were on Delhi, ruling Delhi, and at what time? Rajput dynasties. Early 12th century to 1165, Tomars. Then Angapala, 1130 to 1145. Chauhans from 1165 to 1192. Prithviraj Chauhan, 1175 to 1192. Then after this Rajput dynasties came the early Turkish rulers. From 1209 to 1290, Qutbuddin Aibak from 1206 to 1210, then Shamsuddin Iltutmish or Iltutmish from 1210 to 1236, then Razia from 1236 to 1240, Ghiyasuddin Balban from 1266 to 1287. This is the tomb of Iltutmish, ruled from 1210 to 1236. Then came the Khilji or Khalji dynasty from 1290 to 1320. Jalaluddin Khilji from 1290 to 1296. Then Alauddin Khilji from 1296 to 1310. Then Tughlaq dynasty. See, this is the Firoz Shah Tughlaq tomb. So, Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq from 1320 to 1324, Muhammad Tughlaq from 1324 to 1351, Firoz Shah Tughlaq from 1351 to 1388. Then came for a very short time the Sayyid dynasty, the Khizr Khan from 1414 to 1451, this dynasty, and 1414 to 1421, Khizr Khan. The Lodi dynasty, Bahlul Lodi. From 1451 to 1526, this dynasty, and then Bahlul Lodi from 1451 to 1489. So these are the list or the table of the rulers of Delhi. So let us get back now. And as you saw the table just now, Delhi first became the capital of a kingdom under the Tomar Rajputs, who were defeated in the middle of the 12th century by the Chauhans. We also know them, or they were also referred to as Chahmanas of Ajmer. And it was under these Tomars and Chauhans that Delhi actually became the epicenter, you can say important commercial center. Many rich Jain merchants, they live in the city and they constructed several temples. So coins minted here, called as Delhi Wall, had a wide circulation. So this transformation of Delhi into a capital that controlled vast areas of the subcontinent started with the foundation of Delhi Sultanate in the beginning of the 13th century. So, we have already gone through the various dynasties which ruled over Delhi, or their dynasty or their emperorship was from Delhi. So, the Delhi Sultans built many cities in the area that we see here. Just look at this map. This is the selected Sultanate cities of Delhi, 13th to 14th century, and we can easily point out the Delhi Kohna, we'll be talking about this, and Siri, this one, and this Jahanpana. So we have Jahanpana, Siri, and Delhi Kohna, this area. Now let us know about the Delhi Sultans. Of course, these inscription coins and architecture, they provide a lot of information, especially valuable as are, apart from these are histories, tarikh, or tawarikh, tarikh for singular, tawarikh for plural. This is written in Persian, the language of administration under the Delhi Sultans. So if you see, these are the stages, four stages specifically in the preparation of a manuscript. This is how the preparation of paper goes on, then writing actual text, then melting the gold to highlight important words and passages, and finally preparing the binding. The authors of Tawarikh were learned men, secretaries, administrators, poets, and courtiers, who both recounted events and advised rulers on governance, emphasizing the importance of just rule or justified rule. So there is a circle of justice. Fakr-e-Mudabbir, he wrote in 13th century, a king cannot survive without soldiers. A soldiers cannot live without salaries. Salaries come from the revenue which is collected from peasants or farmers. But peasants can pay revenue only when they are prosperous and happy. And this happens when the king promotes justice and honest governance. So, all these details, if we really consider, then the authors of Tawarikh lived in cities, mainly Delhi, and they hardly ever lived in villages. And they often wrote their histories for sultans in the hope of rich rewards. They wanted good rewards. And these authors advised rulers on the need to preserve an ideal social order based on the birthright and gender distinctions. And the ideas were not shared by everybody. So this birthright is privileged claim on account of birth. For instance, people believed that nobles inherited their right to govern because they were born in certain cities. And gender distinction means social and biological differences between women and men. Usually these differences are used to argue that men are superior to men, to women. So in 1236, Sultan Iltutmish's daughter Razia became Sultan. The chronicler of the age, we have already seen about him, Minhaj-e-Siraj, he recognized that she has or she was more able and qualified than all her brothers. But he was not comfortable at having a queen as a ruler, because the general tendency that the ruler has to be a man. Now, were the nobles happy at her attempts to rule independently? She was removed from the throne in 1240. So, what actually Minhaj-e-Siraj thought about Razia was, Minhaj-e-Siraj thought that the queen's rule went against the ideal social order created by the god, in which the women were supposed to be subordinate to men. So, he therefore asked, in the register of God's creation, since her account did not fall under the column of men, how did she gain from all of her excellent qualities? So on her inscriptions and coins, Razia mentioned that she was the daughter of Sultan Iltutmish, and Iltutmish was a very influential emperor. So this was in contrast to Queen Rudrama Devi. So Rudrama Devi, from 1262 to 1289, of the Kakatiya dynasty of Warangal, part of modern Andhra Pradesh. So Rudrama Devi, she actually changed her name on her inscription and pretended that she is actually not a woman but a man. Another queen, Didda, ruled in Kashmir from 980 to 1003. So her title is interesting. It becomes from Didi, or elder sister, and obviously affectionate term given to a loved ruler by her subjects. From garrison down to empire, this is the expansion of Delhi Sultanate. So this is a map of what we are going to study, major cities captured by Shamsuddin Iltutmish. So in the early 13th century, the control of the Delhi Sultans rarely went beyond heavily fortified towns occupied by the garrisons. So what is this garrison, or what is the garrison town? Garrison town is a fortified settlement with soldiers. So it was beyond heavy, they don't go beyond that. So the sultans seldom controlled the hinterland. What is the hinterland? The land adjacent to a city or a port that supply it with goods and services. So the sultans seldom controlled the hinterland of the cities and were therefore depended upon trade, tribute, or plunder from the supplies. The controlling the garrison towns, as we just saw, in distant Bengal and Sindh from Delhi, it was very difficult. Rebellion or war, even bad weather, could snap fragile communication routes. So the state was also challenged by Mongol invasions from Afghanistan and by governors who rebelled at any sign of if Sultan is somewhat weak. So the Sultan barely survived these challenges. So its expansion occurred during the reigns of Ghiyasuddin Balban, Alauddin Khilji, and Muhammad Tughlaq. So the first set of campaigns along the internal frontier of the Sultan aimed at consolidating the hinterlands of the garrison towns. So during these campaigns, forests were cleared in the Ganga Yamuna Doab, and hunter gatherers and pastoralists expelled from their habitat. So these lands were given to peasants and agriculture was encouraged. New fortresses and towns were established to protect trade routes and to promote regional trade. The second expansion occurred along the external frontier of the Sultanate. So military expeditions into the southern India started during the reign of Alauddin Khilji and culminated with Muhammad Tughlaq. So this is the map of Alauddin Khilji's campaign into South India Sea from Delhi. He ruled or he was campaigning for Gujarat, Mandu, Ranthambore and Dwasamudra, Madurai, Tanjavur, Warangal, Kara. All these were the campaign of Alauddin Khilji. So by the, if you see this map, so what happened? By the end, we were talking about this map actually. And in their campaigns, so the Sultanate armies captured elephants, horses and slaves and carried away precious metals. So by the end of this Muhammad Tughlaq's reign, 150 years after somewhat humble beginnings, the armies of the Delhi Sultanate had marched across a large part of the subcontinent. So they had defeated rival armies and seized the cities. So the Sultanate collected taxes from the peasantry and dispensed justice in its realm. But how complete and effective was its control over such a vast territory? Can you imagine this? These are certain figures which actually speaks about the history of that era. So this is Quwwat al-Islam Mosque and Minare. These are the Minare built during the last decade of the 12th century. And this was the congregation or congregational mosque of the first city built by the Delhi Sultans, described in the chronicles as Delhi Kohna, Delhi Kohna, the old city actually. So the mosque was enlarged by Iltutmish and Alauddin Khilji. The minar was built by three sultans, Qutbuddin Aibak, Iltutmish and Firoz Shah Tughlaq. And this is also the figure, if you see, Begumpuri Mosque, built in the reign of Muhammad Tughlaq. This was the main mosque of Jahanpanah, the sanctuary of the world. What is a masjid? The masjid. So a mosque is called a masjid in Arabic, literally a place where Muslim prostrates in reverence to Allah. So in a congregational mosque, that is masjid, jami or jama masjid, Muslim read their prayers or namaz, offered namaz together. So member of the congregation choose the most respected learned male as their leader, who is called as Imam, for the rituals of prayer. He also delivers the sermon, that is khutbah, during the Friday prayer. And during prayer, Muslims stand facing Makkah. In India, this is in the west, this is called the Qibla. So this is the masjid. Apart from that, Delhi Sultans built several mosques in cities all over the subcontinent. This demonstrated their claims to be protector of Islam and Muslims. So mosque also helped to create the sense of community of believers. So this is the Mot Ki Masjid, built in the reign of Sikandar Lodi by his minister. So mosque also helped to create the sense of community of believers who shared a belief system and a code of conduct. So it was necessary to reinforce this idea of community because Muslims came from a variety of background. This is also the Mosque of Jamali Kamali, built in the late 1520s. Let us have a closer look at the administration and consolidation under the Khiljis or Khaljis and Tughlaqs. So the consolidation of kingdom as vast as the Delhi Sultanate needed reliable governors and administrators. So rather than just appointing aristocrats and landed chieftains as governors, the early Delhi sultans, especially Iltutmish, he favored their special slaves purchased from military service. They called them as bandagan in Persian. So they were carefully trained to man some of the most important political offices in the kingdom. Since they were totally dependent on their master, the Sultan could trust and rely upon them. So it was also being said at that time, slaves rather than sons. The Sultan will advise a slave whom one has brought up and promoted must be looked after for it needs a whole lifetime and good luck to find a worthy and experienced slave. So wise men have said that a worthy and experienced slave is better than a son. Here the word will come, which is client. So client is someone who is under the protection of another or dependent or hanger on. So the Khaljis and Tughlaqs continue to use bandaga and also raise people of humble birth who were often their clients to high, they gave them high political positions. So they were appointed as generals and governors. However, this also introduced an element of political instability. Slaves and clients were loyal to their masters and patrons, but not to their hires. The new sultans had their own servants. As a result, the accession of new monarch often saw the conflict between the old and the new nobility. So the patronage of these humble people by the Delhi Sultans, it also shocked many elites, and the author of Persian Tawarikh criticized the Delhi Sultans for appointing the low and base born to high offices. So if you see the officials of Sultan Muhammad Tughlaq, Sultan Muhammad Tughlaq appointed Aziz Khumar, a wine distiller, Firuz Hajjam, a barber, Man Katabakh, a cook, and two gardeners, Ladha and Pira, to high administrative post. Ziyaduddin Barni, a mid-14th century chronicler, he reported their appointment as a sign of Sultan's loss of political judgment and his incapacity to rule. So like the earlier sultans, the Khalji and Tughlaq monarch appointed military commanders as governors of territories of varying sizes. So these lands were called Iqta, and their holders were called Iqtadar or Mukti. So the duty of Muktis was to lead military campaign and maintain law and order in their Iqtas. So in exchange for their military services, the Muktis collected the revenues of their assignments as salary. So they also paid their soldiers from these revenues. Control over these Muktis was most effective if their office was not inheritable and if they were assigned Iqtas for a short period of time before being shifted. So these harsh conditions of service were rigorously imposed during the reign of Alauddin Khilji and Muhammad Tughlaq. So accountants were appointed by the state to check the amount of revenue collected by the Muktis. Care was taken that the Mukti collected only the taxes prescribed by the state and that he kept the required number of soldiers. So as the Delhi Sultan bought the hinterland of the cities under their control, they forced the land chieftains, that is the Samanta aristocrats and rich landlords, to accept their authority. So under Alauddin Khilji, the state brought the assessment and collection of land revenue under their control. The rights of the chief or local chieftain to levy taxes were cancelled and they were also forced to pay taxes. So the Sultan's administrators measured the land and kept careful account. So some of the old chieftains and landlords of the Sultanate as revenue collectors and assessors. So there were three types of taxes. First, on cultivation called Kharaj, and amounting to about 50% of the peasant production or produce on cattle and on houses. So it is important to remember that large parts of the subcontinent remained outside the control of Delhi Sultan. It was difficult to control such a distant provinces like Bengal from Delhi, and soon after annexing southern India, the entire region again became independent. So even in the Gangetic Plain, there were forested areas. The Sultan's force could not penetrate there. So local chieftains established their rule in these regions, and sometimes rulers like Alauddin Khilji and Muhammad Tughlaq could force their control in these areas, but only for short duration. The Mongols under Genghis Khan or Genghis Khan invaded the Transoxiana. This is the today's Uzbekistan. Transoxiana in northeast Iran in 1219, and Delhi Sultanate faced their onslaught soon after. So Mongol attacks on the Delhi Sultanate increased during the reign of Alauddin Khilji and in the early years of Muhammad Tughlaq's rule. So this forced the two rulers to mobilize a large standing army in Delhi, who posed a huge administrative challenge. Chieftains and their fortification. Ibn Battuta, a 14th century traveler from Morocco, Africa, explained that chieftains sometimes fortify themselves in mountain, in rocky and even rugged places, as well as in bamboo groves. Bamboo groves in India, the bamboo is not hollow, it's big. Its several parts are so intertwined that even fire cannot affect them. And they are on the whole very strong. Bamboos are very strong. So the chieftain live in these forests, which serve them as ramparts, and inside which are their cattle and their crops. So there is also water for them within, that is rainwater, which collects there. So hence they cannot be subdued except by powerful armies who entering their forest cut down the bamboos and with specifically prepared instrument. This is the Ibn Battuta excerpt. So what we are discussing here is that how actually two sultan, that is these two, Alauddin Khilji and Muhammad Tughlaq, dealt with this situation which we just discussed here. Alauddin Khilji and Muhammad Tughlaq. So in Alauddin Khilji, the left hand side, I'm going to speak about the Khilji or Alauddin Khilji, and about Tughlaq in the right hand side. And first is, Delhi was attacked twice in 1299 and 1300, and 1302 to 1303. As a defensive measure, Alauddin Khilji raised a large standing army, while Tughlaq, the Sultanate, was attacked in the early years of Muhammad Tughlaq reign, and the Mongol army was defeated. So Muhammad Tughlaq was confident about the strength of his army and his resources to plan and attack the Transoxiana, that is today's Uzbekistan. He therefore raised a large standing army. Alauddin constructed a new garrison town named Siri for his soldier. Rather than about Tughlaq, rather than constructing a new garrison town, the oldest of the four cities of Delhi, which is Delhi Kohana or Delhi Kohna, was emptied of its residents and the soldiers garrisoned there. The residents of the old city were sent to the new capital of Daulatabad in the south. Then the soldiers have to be fed. We are talking about Khilji here. The soldier had to be fed. This was done through the produce collected as tax from the lands between the Ganga and Yamuna, and tax was fixed at 50% of the peasant's yield. While the Tughlaq, the produce from the same area was collected as tax to feed the army, but to meet the need of the large number of soldiers, the Sultan levied additional taxes, and this coincided with famine in the area, or it actually coincided, you can say, because at that time famine was also there, and this we'll talk about that, how it affected. Then the soldier had to be paid. We are talking about Khilji, so the soldier had to be paid. Alauddin chose to pay his soldiers' salaries in cash rather than ektas. So the soldier would buy their supplies from merchant in Delhi, and it was thus feared that the merchant would raise their price. In order to stop this, Alauddin controlled the The prices of goods in Delhi and prices were carefully surveyed by officers and merchants who did not sell at the prescribed rates. They were punished also. Muhammad Tughlaq also paid his soldier cash salaries, but instead of controlling prices, he used a token currency, somewhat like present day paper currency we have, but made out of cheap metals, not gold and silver. The people in the 14th century did not trust these coins. They were very smart. They saved their gold and silver coins and paid all their taxes to the state with this token currency. And this cheap currency could also be counterfeited easily. Now, coming to administrative measures, Alauddin administrative measures were quite successful, and the chroniclers praise his reign for its cheap prices and efficient supplies of goods in the market. So he successfully withstood the threat of Mongol invasions. While Muhammad Tughlaq administrative measures were a failure, his campaign into Kashmir was a disaster. He then gave up his plans to invade the Transoxiana and disbanded his large army. And meanwhile, his administrative measures created complications. The shifting of people to Daulatabad was greatly resented. The raising of taxes and famine in the Ganga Yamuna belt led to the widespread rebellion, and finally the token currency had to be recalled. So this was, you can say, in tabular form, the distinction of how Alauddin Khilji and Muhammad Tughlaq, they went about their empire. So what we just saw in the list, Muhammad Tughlaq's failure was sometimes forgot that in this, that the first time in the history of Sultanate Delhi, Sultan planned a campaign to capture Mongol territory. He thought about that. So unlike Alauddin's defensive measures, Muhammad Tughlaq's measures were conceived as a part of military offensive against the Mongols. Now the Sultanate in the 15th and 16th century. So we have seen a proper dynasty stable. So you will notice there that after the Tughlaqs, the Sayyid and Lodi dynasties ruled from Delhi and Agra until 1526. So by then the Jaunpur, Bengal, Malwa, Gujarat and Rajasthan and the entire South India had independent rulers who established flourishing states and prosperous capitals. This was also the period which saw the emergence of new ruling groups like the Afghans and the Rajputs. So some of the states established in this period were small but powerful, extremely well administered. Sher Shah Sur, or Sher Shah Suri as we call him, started his career as the manager of small territory from his uncle in Bihar, and eventually challenged and defeated the Mughal Empire Humayun. Sher Shah captured Delhi and established his own dynasty. And although the Suri dynasty ruled for only 15 years, it introduced an administration that borrowed elements from Alauddin Khilji and made them more efficient. The Sher Shah administration became the model followed by the great emperor Akbar when he consolidated the Mughal Empire. So what was going elsewhere? The three orders, the peace of God and knights and the crusades. So the idea of the three orders were first formulated in France in the early 11th century. It divided society into three classes. Three classes: those who prayed first, those who fought, and those who tilled the land. So this division of society into three orders was supported by the church and to consolidate its dominant role in society. So this helped the emergence of new warrior group called the knights. The church patronized this group and used them to propagate their idea of peace of God. The attempt was to direct warriors away from the conflict amongst themselves and set them instead a campaign against the Muslims who had captured the city of Jerusalem. So this led to a series of campaigns called the Crusades, and these campaigns in the service of God and church completely altered the status of knights. So originally these knights did not belong to the class of nobles, but by the end of 11th century in France and century later in Germany, the humble origins of these warriors were forgotten, and by the 12th century, nobles also wanted to be knights, or they wanted to be known as knights only.